Thank you, and thanks to the scientific committee and the organizers for the invitation. This is actually some kind of old work, but it's good that I have now the opportunity to talk about it in this conference, because it's precisely about a certain type of toposis and some properties. So this is infinitary generalizations of this theorem of the Ligne. Let's start with that. So the theorem says that, let's start first with the definition. A coherent topos is, let's recall, is a topos of sheaves for which there is a site on a category with finite limits, and where the Grothendieck topology has a basis consisting of finite covering families. Now, a point of a topos is a geometric morphism from Z, and we say that the collection of points when the collection of points is jointly surjective, that is, the inverse images of the points are jointly conservative, we say that the topos has enough points. So this means that if we have any two subobjects of a given object, the points separate them in the sense that I'm going to have S less or equal than T in the subobject lattice if and only if, for every point P, the inverse image on S is less or equal than the inverse image of T. So, and the Ligne's theorem says that a coherent topos belongs to certain classes of topos which have enough points. It is essentially a completeness theorem. I call it the Ligne's completeness theorem because it's essentially Gödel's completeness theorem for first order classical logic. Now, I'm being a bit imprecise there in with the essentially, because it's rather coherent logic what we are talking about there. But via modelization, we can reduce any classical first order logic to theory to a coherent theory. So the connection is that, in fact, the syntactic category of a coherent theory or of a first order classical theory is a coherent category, and then we can take the topos of sheaves over that with the coherent coverage, and we will get a coherent topos that will have enough points. So those will provide the models of our theory. Now there is another type of toposes with enough points that was found out by Mackay and Reyes in their book, First Order Categorical Logic. Those are the separable toposes. So a separable topos is a topos of sheaves for which there is a site on a category with countably many objects and morphisms, and where the Grothendieck topology is generated by countably many covering families. So, so that's a separable topos. And Mackay and Reyes proved that a separable topos is another example that has enough points. So this is, of course, related, and the way it's been proven, to a completeness theorem, now for an infinitary logic. So is infinitary classical logic over this language, L omega 1 omega. So this means that we allow countably many conjunctions and disjunctions there, but only finitely many variables quantified at the same time. And so with the same argument as before, we can see that what this is saying is that these infinitary theories have satisfy a completeness theorem. Of course, here we're talking about a weak completeness theorem in the sense that sentences that are valid turn out to be provable, but not whole theories. Well, it could be a whole theory only if it has at most countably many axioms, because then I can just use an infinitary conjunction of countable size and put it as a sentence, basically. But more importantly, this entails a completeness theorem for countably axiomatized geometric theory. So in general, geometric logic does not satisfy a completeness theorem, But if you require your theory to be axiomatized by countably many axioms in canonical form, then it turns out to be complete with respect to set valued models, again for these sentences. So our goal here is to replace omega, to realize that this is not, has to do anything in particular with omega, the case of the countability, but in fact we can replace omega with any cardinal kappa that satisfies this cardinality condition here, kappa to the less than kappa equals kappa. So kappa to the less than kappa is here the sum of kappa to the lambda for lambda less than kappa. And I'm saying, well, this has to be such that this sum of cardinals is exactly kappa, no more than that. And in that case, we will get a completeness theorem for infinitary classical logic over L kappa plus kappa. Kappa plus is the successor cardinal of kappa. So this is a precise generalization of the separable toposes. So we are going to use some sort of kappa separability notion. And in particular, this will generalize the geometric theories to what we will call kappa geometric theories. But it turns out that the completeness theorem here for L kappa plus kappa are new. So through the categorical language, we can provide new completeness theorems for infinitary logic. So which types of kappa satisfy this condition, then, is the question. So in principle, for example, any inaccessible cardinal satisfy that condition, but we do not have to go all the way to inaccessibility. If you don't mind using the generalized continuum hypothesis, then any regular cardinal already satisfies that condition. So under GCH, any regular cardinal, any successor of any cardinal, satisfies that condition. So that gives us a lot of variety of such cardinals. And this cardinality comes, so the origin of this comes from the fact that when you fix the language to be of size kappa, the number of different formulas that you can form in this language is precisely this, kappa to the less than kappa. So we're saying the number of free variables that I have in my language is equal to the number of possible formulas that I have. Okay. Incidentally, when we make further assumptions on kappa, for example, that it be weakly compact, we will be able to have a proper infinitary de Ligne's theorem for L kappa kappa now. So we will have a kappa coherent theory, we will have a kappa coherent topos. In that case, the covering families will have size less than kappa, and it will have, well, I'm going to talk about it, enough kappa points. I will explain what it is. So this kappa geometric logic is an extension of geometric logic in which we have the arities are bound to be less than kappa, but not necessarily finite. So functions, relations, symbols have arities less than kappa, and in general, a formula has less than kappa many free variables, not necessarily finitely many. We are allowed to take conjunctions of less than kappa many formulas. So unlike in geometric theories where we are restricted to take finite conjunctions only. And the crucial thing is that we are allowed to take an existential quantification simultaneously on less than kappa many variables at the same time. We also need more logical axioms to be added, because the thing is that if we increase the expressivity of the language, as we did in that case, there are things that we would like to be part of our axiomatization because are valid, and yet they are not derivable from the axioms of pure finitary geometric logic. For example, the axiom of choice, which I can write as if I have a conjunction of exist xi such that phi I of xi, this entails that there exists x0, x1, etc. So I quantify and I take the big conjunction of the phi i's. So this is a form of the axiom of choice, is expressible in this language yet not provable from the other axiom. So I certainly have to add to find a good axiomatization for this logic. Okay, why, yes?
These functions are set index.
Set index, yes, yes, yes. Why would I want to extend geometric logic to this other type of infinitary logic? Well, it turns out that we need to study other types of theories which are not axiomatized, are not geometric, but happen to be kappa geometric. For example, the theory of well orderings. The theory of well orderings is axiomatized as follows. I have an axiom there saying that for all xy, this is a, this relation is a total order. And then the crucial axiom, which says that there are no infinite descending chains there, is using a quantification over infinitely many variables and an infinite conjunction. So, okay, from these two axioms, we can derive, for example, the transitivity property for the order. So these are enough to axiomatize well orderings. And the interesting fact is that, shown by López Escobar, this theory is not axiomatizable in any L kappa omega. So even if you take conjunctions or disjunctions of arbitrary size, but only finite many quantifications, quantification of a finite many variables, then you are not going to be able to axiomatize this theory. Instead, as a kappa geometric theory for any kappa bigger than omega, we will be able to apply all the techniques to this theory. For example, we will be able to prove that it has what will we call a kappa classifying topos, which I will explain what a kappa topos is, and so on. So to summarize, we have new axioms, but if we restrict ourselves to this fragment instead of the full first order infinitary fragment logic, we need to put it as rule of inferences, these new axioms. The rule will in turn correspond to an exactness property of the associated category. So I will have a kappa geometric category, which will be the category associated to kappa geometric logic. And it will have an exactness property corresponding to this new rule of inference that I will add. So that's what gives rise to these categories. And in turn, the kappa geometric categories will have a kappa classifying topos. What do I mean by that? So suppose I have the syntactic category of my kappa geometric category theory. I use the geometric coverage and I embed it into the topos of sheaves conservatively. And then, well, first of all, the exactness property that C has will be inherited by the sheaf topos here. So this will be a kappa topos. I will explain what it is. So it is in essentially that it has a certain exactness property. And the universal property in this case will be that if I have any other topos with that exactness property and any model of my theory in that topos, then that will correspond to a geometric morphism whose inverse image will preserve not only finite limits, but in fact all kappa small limits. So it will be what I call a kappa geometric morphism. So in a sense, the inverse image of a kappa geometric morphism preserves all the kappa structure of the theory, of the logic.
But you won't have a unimodal property
in only in the kappa toposes. See, yes, we have to restrict ourselves to the category of kappa toposes with kappa geometric morphisms. That I will talk about later. It's an interesting choice, and in fact, the kappa toposes are the right notion of a Grothendieck topos for an infinitary logic. It's the right place where to study infinitary logic. So this will lead us to the notion of what I call a kappa separable topos, which will be a topos of sheaves for which there is a site on a category with kappa small limits, at most kappa many objects and morphisms, where the basis for the Grothendieck topology is generated by at most kappa many covering families, and that satisfy this. I mean, up to now, if I just put those three conditions, that's clearly not enough. That will not make the topos have enough of these kappa points. But if I add a further exactness property, which I will explain now, then they will have enough kappa points. So that's the theorem. Kappa separable toposes have enough of these kappa points, points where the inverse image preserves all kappa small limits. So this is what generalizes the separable toposes of Mackay and Reyes. Okay, so.
So in particular, they will have enough points.
In particular, yes. But you can say more than that. So what is the exactness property that I'm talking about? I put T because I call it transfinite transitivity, because it's a transfinite version of the transitivity property of Grothendieck topologies in essence. So first, I mean, it's a bit complicated, so I will first do it in the propositional case, in the localic case. Suppose we have a localic topos. Suppose we have a local. We want to determine kappa points of a local. So we want to define enough, we want the local to have enough points, but points that in addition preserve kappa small intersections. So this corresponds to kappa complete, completely prime filters on the frame. Okay, so what is the property that it needs to have? If I wanted to have enough kappa points, I want the points of the local to separate the elements of the complete Heyting algebra, then I need to have a certain distributivity property holding in the frame. And the distributivity property is the following. Suppose I have a tree in which the nodes are elements of the frame such that every node is the join of the immediate successors. But a tree of transfinite height. So at limit levels, when I reach limit ordinals, I just take the intersection of the predecessors. Okay. I can do that as long as I want. I will reach a certain, suppose I go to up to kappa. Now, what I'm saying is that if there are enough of these kappa points, the distributivity property that this local has to have is the following. If I choose any level of the tree, as long as every node is the join of the successors, and at limit levels, every node is the intersection of the immediate of all the predecessors, then the root of the tree will have to be the join of all the nodes in that level. That is the distributivity property. And in fact, I can say more. I can say that the level does not have to be a uniform level. I can choose, as long as I choose for every branch of the tree a certain point in the branch, and not necessarily at the same height, then as long as I do that and I intersect every branch of the tree, then the root will have to be the join of all the points that I have chosen. So this is what generates what is called a bar in the tree, which is an upward close subset of nodes intersecting every branch. And so why do I have to have that distributivity property? Because if the kappa points separate the elements, and it was false that the root r is not less or equal than the join of these AIs, then I would be able to find a completely prime kappa complete filter containing R and disjoint from this joint. But if it contains R, because this is the joint of the successors, it must contain one of the successors. Because this is the joint of the others, it must contain one of the successors in turn, and so on. And I can define a branch that at some point will hit the minimal elements of the bar. So I reach a contradiction. So I do need this distributivity property. In logical language, well, it turns out to be expressible as an inference rule saying, okay, if here I assign elements of the or propositional formulas to the nodes of the locale, and each one entails the joint of the successors, and at limit levels I take the intersection of the predecessors, and then the root has to be the joint of all the these points, the elements of the given bar. So it's a bit complicated, but is what you need, because it turns out that as soon as you add this rule of inference to the logic, to the geometric logic, you get a completeness theorem, so you can prove that the locale will have enough kappa points. So just to compare it with the usual kappa distributivity is when I have a big intersection of a joint of AIJs, and that implies that a big joint over all the functions from gamma to gamma of that intersection there. So this is kappa distributivity, but the property here, the transfinite transitivity, propositional version, is strictly stronger than just this. For example, you can take the complete Heyting algebra given by the interval 0, 1 with the usual order. So the supremum is the joint, the intersection will be the inf. And you could put, for example, the element 1 in here and choose the immediate successors to be elements such that the sup of this is 1, but they are strictly less than 1. And you could do that at each level of the tree. So if you do that, what will happen is that all the premises of the rule will be true, but if you go high enough, so if you choose, for example, a kappa bigger than omega 1, you cannot have an infinite decreasing, a decreasing sequence, strictly decreasing sequence of reals of cardinality more than omega. So the thing is that already at level omega 1, all of this will be necessary 0, and then it's not true that 1 is the joint of all the zeros. So that property is strictly stronger than the distributivity property, but it implies it. So the kappa distributivity is a particular case of this property there. So this explains why there are locales with no points. Locales with no points correspond to geometric theories which are consistent and yet have no models. So the reason why there are geometric theories which are consistent and have no models, well, it's because you are missing some axioms there. As soon as you add the rule of inference, you will be able to derive a contradiction on any theory which has no models. For example, the typical theory of injections of an uncountable set into the natural numbers has no models, so this is axiomatized with propositional variables. PAN here refers to the function f, the value on a being n. So I'm saying here the first and third axiom is saying that it's a function indeed. So I have just one value for each a. And the second one is saying that it's injective. So for A be different, I cannot have both this. So this theory, as a geometric theory, is consistent. But if you put the rule that I showed before in the previous slides, you will be able to derive the contradiction. So imagine that you put in here, on each node, an instance of this big disjunction here. So you put the root 1 and the PANs here. On the next immediate successors of this, you put another of these disjunctions for a different A, and so on and so on. At each level of the tree, you use a different A. When you go up to omega 1, the thing is that no matter which branch of the tree you choose, there are only countably many natural numbers, and so you will have to repeat two of them. For two of them that you repeat, since you are taking the intersections at limit levels, you will reach bottom. So in fact, you will be able to form, to find a node in each branch, which is equivalent to bottom. And if I'm saying that this is jointly covering, this is a contradiction. So this is considered as a kappa geometric propositional theory will be inconsistent. So we'll explain why the locale didn't have points. Okay, so that's the propositional case. So now that I've really been explaining the propositional case, the first order case will be easier. For the first order case, I don't have necessarily monomorphisms here, but I have arrows. And what I'm saying is that at each object of my kappa geometric category, I have a jointly conservative set of arrows. So the union of the images of those arrows will be the whole object. So here I'm simply explaining, I'm considering kappa chains in the category. So I'm assuming the category has kappa limits, and I have morphisms like that, which correspond to a branch here in the tree. And the condition is that at limit levels, I have to say what I do at limit levels, well, I take the limit. I mean, I cannot compose infinitely many arrows, but what I can do at limit levels is taking the limit, and therefore I form a new object in the category, and I continue with jointly covering families. And so I will say that these morphisms compose transfinitely. And the projections from the limit at any level will be the transfinite composites of all the arrows in the branch. So the rule, the exactness property T, says, which is transfinite transitivity, says that if we have such a tree of morphisms, where the immediate successors of every node form a jointly covering family, then the transfinite composite of the morphisms along all possible branches of the tree forms itself a jointly covering family. If you think about it in terms of a Grothendieck topology, you could define a kappa Grothendieck topology by saying, okay, if this family is covering, I compose transfinitely many of them, and I still get a covering family, a family in the topology. That is a closure condition that I put on the topology, and it makes it into a kappa topology. What it turns out is that if you take sheaves with that topology, you get a topos that satisfies the transfinite transitivity property. Okay, so I just said this, a kappa geometric category has kappa small limits, complete subobject lattices with stable unions, and satisfy the transfinite transitivity property. And the only thing that I have to, on the logical side, add are the images here of the, so I'm saying each formula is covered by the immediate successors, and I get this. So here I'm using an infinite array quantification. Okay, this is the rule that is a logical axiom valid in set, and that I have to add to the logic to get a completeness theorem. So which are examples of Kappa geometric categories? You have set, of course. I mean, if you have jointly epic families here, and you take a point in the set of the base, this point will have to come from one of the successors, and so on and so on. So you will be able to define a branch and hitting at some point the bar. Pre-shift toposes, because essentially everything is computed point-wise. And also what I just said, if you put a Kappa topology, so a topology, a Grothendieck topology satisfying this transformation transitivity property, the topos of sheaves on that side will also satisfy that property. One can prove that. And in fact, the syntactic category of any Kappa geometric theory is an example of a Kappa geometric category. So there you get, I'm implicitly saying that there is a completeness theorem in terms of models in Kappa geometric categories there due to the syntactic construction. So how many Kappa separable topos are there? I mean, if we need to find examples. So a way of generating examples is one way is very easy. We start with a category of size at most Kappa, so at most Kappa many objects and morphisms, and with Kappa small limits. For example, the syntactic category of any infinitary Cartesian theory will be such a case. Choose arbitrarily Kappa many families over each object that you will want to be covering, but you choose in an arbitrary way. Then you close it under the closure condition of the, given by the transfinite transitivity property, which will take at most Kappa plus iterations, and then you get a Kappa separable topos. So that will have enough Kappa points. In particular, when Kappa is omega, an omega separable topos is just the separable topos of Makayan-Reyes. And that's because one can prove that any Grothendieck topology is an omega topology. So even if the disjunction here so is bigger than Kappa, you will still be able to prove that up to omega, the joints of the elements at any bar will be jointly covering. Okay, so what are the main results and the applications of this completeness theorem? So we said already this. I should add that this is best possible in terms of the cardinality of the theories involved. So in the same way as geometric theories with countably many axioms are complete, I have that Kappa geometric theories with at most Kappa many axioms are also complete, and that's the best we can do. There's a result of Specker saying that there are Kappa theories axiomatized by Kappa plus axioms, which are consistent but have no model. So that's the most I can do. This is important. They coincide with, they are precisely the Kappa classifying toposes of Kappa geometric theories with at most Kappa many axioms. So those classes of toposes coincide, the Kappa separable and these ones. Then, okay, so if you want to add large cardinal assumptions, when you add the weak compactness, you suddenly simplify, because then every bar can be shown to be refined to a uniform bar. So you are just talking about uniform levels in the tree. Then you get Kappa de Ligne's theorem, a Kappa coherent topos has enough Kappa points, which is essentially Karp's completeness theorem for infinitary logic L Kappa Kappa. Okay, this is another application. You can go all the way up to infinitary first order logic, generalizing a theorem of Joyal, which says that if you have a first order theory, you take the coherent models, and then you take pre-shifts on that, and here you use an evaluation functor, so each formula is sent to evaluate that a model gives the extension of the formula in that model. Joyal proved that this preserves universal quantification. You can run the same argument as Jojal. I mean, there is something to check, of course, but you run that argument and the same will be valid for infinite array logic. So the completeness for the kappa coherent theories will show that this is conservative, and hence you will have a Kripke model, which is essentially a pre-sheave, for infinite array intuitionistic first order logic. Then Stone dualities arise when kappa is weakly compact because you are talking about the generalized Cantor space 2 to the kappa, which turns out to be kappa compact in that case. Every open cover has a subcover of less than kappa many opens. So you get even a completeness for intuitionistic first order logic over L kappa plus kappa. Okay, so just very quickly, 1 minute. Okay, this is another thing, but it really has to be another talk because so Stone duality for first order logic done by Mackay says that there is a duality between pretoposes and ultra categories. We can generalize this to the infinite array case thanks to the completeness theorem, and we will get a duality between kappa pretoposes on one side and accessible kappa ultra categories that are equivalent to models of kappa first order theories. There's a lot to say about that. I mean, Kissler-Shela doesn't generalize, and we need to use some large cardinals, but okay. Then another thing that Sawadowski asked me, if using Mackay's duality that I got in another work, one could prove the descent theorem for kappa pretoposes in the same way that he did for pretoposes. This has a positive answer, and this entails a definability theorem for infinite array logic. And finally, there's also Audi for shell duality, which is more topological, that can also be generalized thanks to this kappa classifying topos. Okay, that's all. Thanks.